creation, all of creation, bow before the ancient of days.
Every tongue
in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you'll be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O ancient of days.
Amen.
Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the ancient of days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the ancient of days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you'll be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O ancient of days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth. Sing unto the ancient of days. For none can compare to your matchless work. Sing unto the ancient of days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth. Sing unto the ancient of days. For none can compare to your matchless work. Sing unto the ancient of days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you'll be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O ancient of days, O ancient of days, O ancient of days, O ancient of days.
Amen. And with that, we will sing our hymn of praise number 317. Lead me to Calvary.
King of my life, I crown thee now. Thine shall the glory be. Lest I forget thy thorn crown well, lead me to Calvary.
Oh,
lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. Show me the tomb where thou once laid, tenderly mourned and wept. Angels in robes of light arrayed guarded the walls thou slept. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. Let me like Mary through the gloom come with a gift to thee. Show to me now the empty
not forget thine agony. Lest thou forget thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary. May I be willing, Lord, to bear daily my cross for thee. Even thy cup of grief to share, thou hast borne all for me. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary.
Amen, amen, amen. We will tune our voices as we sing this powerful song. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hymn number 569. We'll sing the first verse, first verse and chorus.
Pass me not, O gentle
church say amen. It is prayer time. I know that we do not have the prayer basket, but let me say this, that I believe in prayer. And if there is somebody who wants us to pray for them, just hold up your hand. God sees those hands. Thank you. God sees those hands. And for you online, if you want us to just pray for you, you can just put your hand up using that chat. All right, we're asking everyone to just assume a position of prayer right now. Almighty God, you are the one who sits high and you look low. Your eyes move to and fro. You see everything that is happening in this world. There is nothing that is hidden from your sight. You are in control of everything, even though things may seem not to go as we are expecting. God, we are so grateful because you love us with an everlasting love. It is with loving kindness that you have drawn us to you. You have taken us out of darkness You placed us in your marvelous light. We thank you so much that even when we did not care about you and your existence, dear God, you still cared about us. And the Holy Spirit of God kept on prompting us, and here we are. And we say thanks. God, we come as we are. We're sinful. We are unholy. Our righteousness is like filthy rags. We have come to you saying, God, please accept us. Forgive us our sins. Remove this robe of righteousness and give us yours, that because yours is holy. And so, God, when we are forgiven, we know that we are clean. You said, if my people who are called by my name, we are your people, that if we humble ourselves and if we pray, you will hear us. When we turn away from our wicked ways and we pray, you will hear us. You will forgive us our sins. You will heal. And so, God, we are just giving you the honor and the glory and the praise. There is no other place that we would want to be but in the house of God, where your Shekinah glory is. Father, we are asking you to be with us in a mighty way. Sometimes, Lord, we may be discouraged. Sometimes we may be feeling sad. There are some in the audience right now who may be going through a situation, and in their heart, they may be crying out to you. They may be wondering, where is God? Is God really there? And so, God, I pray that you will touch that person. Let that person understand that the tears you see, those tears, you understand the pain, and you are there. You are there. So, Lord, let your Spirit give some peace and some love, because you are the God of love. You are the one who sent your Son to die for us. What greater love is that? To die for us. And because of Christ's death, we can have that assurance of heaven. I pray that, God, you will just be with each and every one. Lord, whatever situation that they are dealing with, Lord, you have seen the hands of those who have held up their hands. They are asking for prayer because they believe, like Abraham believed, that there is power in the name of the Lord and there is power in prayer. And so, God, you have seen those hands. I pray according to your will that, God, whatever they're asking, that you will provide, whether it is healing, God. And we know that we live in a sin-sick world that brings forth diseases. God, I'm asking you to bring some relief to someone, dear God, that you'll bring forth healing, dear God, and let that person know it is you who brought forth the healing. I pray that, Lord, if there's a family situation, that you would show up for that person. I pray, dear God, that if there is a job crisis, whatever the situation is, God, I pray in the name of Jesus that this very day that their prayers will be answered. God, I pray for our young people. They have to compete so much with things out there, social media and other things. God, it is a battle for the mind. And so, Father, I pray for them that you will cover them, for those who are gone out in as pathfinders. God, I pray that wherever they are at this moment, that you will cover them, that you will bless them, that you will keep them, because they are our young people. They are the teachers, they are the preachers, not only of today, but of tomorrow also, God. So bless them and keep them. I pray for the man of the hour, God. your manservant, the one who will be bringing the word on your behalf. Holy Father, I pray that you will touch him. I pray, dear God, that you will give him the words that he will say. Lord, we are waiting for a word from you. Speak through your manservant today so that your people will be blessed. And God, we look forward to that time when all is said and done. And when Christ will put forth his appearing, I pray that everyone in this audience and those online who, Lord, they have given their lives to you, I pray, dear God, that they too and all of us will enter into your kingdom. Bless us to this end, we pray, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit of God. Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen.
We're here today because, sad to say, we're no good, but we're trying to be good. But the good thing is we serve a great God, and so we'll be singing about how great our God is. Amen. If you know the song, please feel free to sing along with us. If you want to stand, you can stand. If you want to sit, that's okay. How great is our God? It says the splendor of a king in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light and darkness tries to hide, but still trembles at his voice. It says, how great is our God? How great is our God? Age to age he stands and time is in his hands, beginning and the end. We'll have the deacons and deaconesses come forward to do the tithe and offering, and we'll come back to the praise and worship.
What are the blessings of tithing? It enables you to prove your faith in God as your source. It enables you to prove God in your finances. God promises to open the windows of heaven upon you. God will pour out blessings upon you. He gives to all life and breath and all things. The silver is mine, the gold is mine, and the silver is mine, the gold is mine. The Lord directed that a portion of his bounties should be returned to him in gifts and offerings to sustain his worship. Our tithes and offering will be collected today, and there are still areas in the sanctuary. There are places you can still put your tithes if you wish to. Online, for those of our listeners online, you can go to PikesvilleSDA.org, or you could call a deacon or a deaconess to collect it, or you could mail to Pikesville Church, 4619 Old Port Road, Pikesville, Maryland, 21208. We will now collect the day's offering.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love, at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King.
We give
thee but thine own, whatever gift may be. All that we have is thine alone. I trust, O Lord, from thee. We give thee but thine alone, I trust, O Lord, from thee. Amen.
Loving Lord, we are so thankful that you have allowed your people to return to you. We ask, dear Lord, that you will continue to bless those hearts and those hands. And as this goes forward to do your work, dear God, may your people be blessed. Bless those that did not have to give. And we pray, God, that you will give them the ability, dear Father, to do what you have asked us all to do. And we thank you for your blessings in Jesus' name. Bless the offering again. In your name we pray. Amen.
good to us. So please testify how awesome your God has been. You can have a seat, my brother. I'll just do the special song that says, I'm free from the guilt that I carried. Praise God, I'm free.
Enslaved by the world and my greed, then the door for a glorious song. is the Lord free at last. I am free from the guilt that I carry, from this dark, empty life I'm set free. For when I met Jesus, he made me complete, and he forgot the foolish child I used to be. Oh, I'm free from the fears of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of my past. Oh, I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. I'm free, praise the Lord, free at last.
I am free, free at last. God is awesome. Our God is awesome. I am free, free at last. That is the hope of every Christian. I am free, free at last. Free at last. Let me join Brother Tyler to welcome every single one into the sanctuary this morning. And also, those of us who are online, I want to welcome you, and I want to ask you to stay and listen to what the Lord has for you this morning. The Lord is good. The Lord is too good to me. I can't begin to explain it. You know, if you give me the chance, I'm going to be jumping up and letting you know how good the Lord has been. I want to thank you, Sister Grace, for that wonderful song. It's very timely, extremely timely. So welcome every single one of us into the sanctuary this morning. You know, the Lord has been good. You know, it says that I was glad when they said to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. You see, the words of the psalmist can be so easily overlooked as simple praise, yet they speak a profound truth. Psalm 122 begins with this joyous acclamation of the sheer joy, happiness, an absolute pleasure in attending church worship. You know, this is the day the Lord has made. But to face you, where are you? This is the day the Lord has made, and I will be glad and rejoice in it. You know, the Lord is good. The Lord is very good. I want to use this opportunity to thank the pastor one more time, Pastor Babawale Adepoju, you know, for giving me the opportunity to be, you know, behind his pulpit one more time to encourage the saints of God. You know, because sometimes, you know, when we stand behind the pulpit, we say a lot of things. But this morning, I have come by here to encourage everyone that is sitting here and those of us who are online this morning. The Lord is good. If you are a Christian who is aiming for the kingdom of God, I have come by here to tell you that the journey or the race is not a sprint. The race is not the sprint like you know it. Like Usain Bolt, you know Usain Bolt. Like Asafa Powell, you know Asafa Powell, you know, a great runner. Or like Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce. You know, I know you know them all. It's not a sprint. It's not a 100 yard run. Brethren, I want to tell you that it is a marathon. This race that we are on is a marathon. And let me tell you, this race, your patience is measured, your endurance is measured, and your strength is also measured. Let me say that again. Your patience is measured, your endurance is measured, and also your strength is measured. And when you run, it doesn't matter. You know, when you started running, doesn't matter when you started running. And when you run, it doesn't matter, you know, how fast you go. Doesn't matter how fast you go. And let me tell you, it does not matter how fast you go. It doesn't matter when you started. The fact is, are you going to be able to finish the race? Will you endure while you are running to finish the race? It's not for the swift, you know. It is for those who will endure to the end. So it doesn't matter. It is not a race where, you know, I will come and tell you, I'm done running. I'm waiting for you to finish. No. There is no one who is last. There is nobody who is first in this race. The fact remains, are you going to be able to finish the race? So it's all about endurance. It's all about being able to hold on. What am I calling? It's all about being able to be strong. It doesn't matter the crucible that you're having. The fact is, the Bible says, hold on. I remember a preacher that came here a few weeks ago and said, you know, the Lord is betting on you. The fact is, he's telling you to hold on. It doesn't matter what situation you find yourself. The fact is, hold on. Because this race, it's a race, not for the swift. It's for those who would wait and endure until the race is over. So, brethren, this morning, it is not how fast that you finish, but how well you finish. It is not how fast that you finish this race, but how well you finish this race. And so I'm asking us to hold on. Just hold on, because the Lord is going to be with you. Like Elder Madison said this morning, the Lord is going to be with us as long as we have this hope. As long as you have the hope, the Lord is going to be with you and he's going to see you through. Just hold on, because it is how well you finish this race. Let us bow our heads. Father in heaven, we want to thank you so much for what you've done for us this morning. For waking us up this morning, oh Lord, and helping us, directing us to bring us here to worship you. Our Lord, our God, we want to thank you. We are asking that you continue to bless us, oh Lord. Be with us and guide us, Father in heaven. Father in heaven, I pray for myself. I'm asking that you please be with me. Hide me somewhere behind the shadow of the cross. And help that what I will deliver today will be the word that you put in my heart for your people this morning. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I'm going to call on my wife, Claudia, to come and read the Bible study. While she's coming, please, shall we all stand as the Bible reading is read. Let's read.
Okay. 1 John 4, starting from verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, for God is love, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. In verse 12, no one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love has been perfected in us.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Claudia. Thank you for that wonderful, well read. You may be seated. Thank you. You may be seated. You know, my topic is the absolute yardstick of a true Christian. The absolute yardstick of a true Christian is based on 1 Corinthians 13. We're going to get to that, you know, as we continue. But what I want to tell us this morning is that every single thing we do on earth is measured. Everything we do is measured. You know, in this society, you know, people measure your success by the kind of car you drive, the kind of house you live, the kind of education you have, and they measure success by that. But the preacher said, those are vanity. The preacher made it clear that those are vanity. We cannot begin to measure your success by that. But that's how the society measures the success of anyone. Now, you have to understand that even the blood work that you do, you go to the hospital, you do a blood work, the blood work is also measured because there's a value. Now you have that value, and then you have also a standard with which that value is measured. For example, you go and then the block is done, and then you know you get your result. Look at your result. It says, this is your value, and this is the standard value. For example, if you take a test, you know, for blood sugar, your level, it tells you this is your value, but this is the standard value. Then you have to look and see if you're too much or if you're too little or if you're within the range. Also, you know, when you cook, you have to measure the amount of pepper you put in that, in what you cook. Otherwise, it's going to be either too much or too little, or there's none at all. So every single thing we do is measured. I am a physician assistant by trade. And of course, not just a physician assistant, I am a surgical physician. So in other words, all I do is surgery. So we measure every single thing. Before we make an incision, we have to mark the area that we have to measure to make sure that it's not too big, and also to make sure it's not too little. Because if it's too little, it'll be difficult for us to, you know, take out what we need to take out. Or if it's too big, then we make it difficult for the patient because, you know, it's not going to appear very nice after you sew it up. The cosmetics will not look very great.
And so we have to measure. And now when you go in, I remember when I used to put my hands into guts, or you know, the stomach of the patient, you know, put my hands and move all the bile away so that we can get to where we're going. That too has to be measured. I cannot pull too much. Because if I pull too much, I might destroy other organs. And if I pull too little, the surgeon is not going to see what he wants to see or what she wants to see. And so everything is measured. And now, because everything is measured, the Christian life or the Christian, the true Christian, also got to be measured. Got to be measured. You have to know if you are really a true Christian or if you're not. And sometimes we think that we are true Christians. We think we have arrived sometimes, you know, but in the real sense, when it's measured, when your spirituality is measured, you find yourself wanting sometimes. But the idea is, how do you measure? What is the yardstick to use to measure, you know, your as a true Christianity? And so that's where we begin. That's where we begin. So let us grab our Bibles or get our phones and also, if you want to mark or if you want to write something down, I need us to begin. I need you to open to 1 Corinthians chapter number 13. We're going to be dealing exactly with what is in there. Chapter number 13, because it's very, very intriguing. And let me tell you, that's how you measure a true Christian. That is how you measure. And again, this is like Laodicean Church. It's either you are or you are not. There is no in between. You can't sit on the fence one more time, because most of us want to sit on the fence and then put our journey on cruise control. And then when we put our journey on cruise control and we're sitting on the fence, not knowing that we are not worthy. And so it reads, I'm going to read it with the New King James Version, because that kind of makes more sense. Let me read verse 1 of chapter number 13. It says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. Let us stop there. Even though I do what? I speak with the tongues of men and angels. Men and angels. In other words, even if you preach like Paul, if you preach and sound like an angel, but you have no love, you are not, you are making just noise. I don't belong to that category. And take it or leave it, the fact is, if you do not love, you can't say, I love, but I don't. The fact is, that word love we are talking about, agape love, the love that Christ has for you and me, the love that God has for you and me, that he said, well, listen, let me send my only begotten son. I cannot send Micah to die for nobody. I'm not going to do that. Will you? The fact is, you can't. The fact you cannot send your only son to go and die on behalf of anyone. The fact remains, but God did so. God did so for me and for you. He did that because of what? Because he loves us. And he is admonishing us, giving us that same admonition. Barakati, where are you? Good to see you. He is giving us that admonition to do what? To love one another. To love. And To love is just not to say it. I know a lot of people like to say, I love you. I love you, sister. I love you, my brother. The fact is, love is an action word. It's something that you must do. It's not something you just have to say. It's something that you must do. And therefore, the Bible is telling you, even if you have the voice of an angel, and you know, you have you can preach, you can talk, you have this gift of eloquency, and you don't have any love, you better believe it. It's over. It's over. You must love your fellow human beings, just like God loves you. And we are not loving our fellow human beings because God has first loved us. He has first loved you and me. And that's why he gave his only begotten son to die on the cross of Calvary. Let us continue. And so, verse 2 says, and though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains but have not love, I am nothing. I did not say that. The Bible says it. The Bible says it. You know, so if you, I know, you know, Adventists, we know the prophecy. We know it very well. You know, even if you get a youth, get him up tomorrow at night, middle of night, he can tell you the prophecy. Even though you have that understanding, you know it very well, and then you can expatiate it very well. The fact is, if you know all these things and have the love, you are absolutely nothing. I want to let you know that you are absolutely nothing if you don't have love. So I'm asking you this morning to go and develop love for your neighbors. You go and develop love for your sister. Go and develop love for your brother and people who are outside, even your enemies. The Bible said it. The Bible said we should love our enemies to a point where we have to pray for them. That we have to pray for them. The fact remains, we can't just have all this big faith. You know, the faith that we have to be able to remove the Mount Kilimanjaro, you know, the faith that we have, we can move, you know, the biggest mountain on earth. But the fact is, if we have that and don't have love, we are joking. And most of us like to joke. We like to joke, you know, because, you know, we are born Adventists. I don't know if you've heard that before. You know, I'm a born Adventist. So what? If you're a born Adventist, so what? Like I told you from the beginning, that this race, it doesn't matter when you start. It doesn't matter when you get in. The fact is, are you going to be able to hold on to finish? So being a born Adventist does not mean anything. I know that's what we are. Because we are born Adventists, so what it is that we know this ritual. Our ritual is come to church every Sabbath morning. Every Sabbath morning, we get dressed and come to church because we are Adventists. We are born Adventists. My mother took me to church. My father took me to church, and therefore we are born Adventists. Why are you coming to church? Why are you coming to church? You coming to church because it's a ritual? Because if you don't show up, Elder Matheson is going to ask you, oh, hey, why were you not in church? And then you begin to, you know, find something to say. Or you come into church because you should be in church. Or you know who God is and you love God just like he says us do. So you can't avoid loving somebody. Even if it doesn't matter what they have done to you. My brother asked a question this morning. Very valid question. You know, I mean, what did Job's friends, you know, they what did they do wrong? You know, how did they, you know, look at the whole thing? What about Job's wife? Look at, you know, his children died and things like that. The fact is, it's not about you. It's not about us. In every situation, the Lord himself got to be glorified, even in my death. If I fall down today and die, there is a reason why. And only God knows why. Don't question him. And so, if you have all these things, all these big gifts and things like that, you know, and then you can move mountains and you don't have that charity, the love we're talking about here, you are absolutely nothing. And so I don't want to be nothing. Do you? Do you want to be nothing? Do you at the end of your race, and the Lord is going to put you on the balances and then found you wanting? Just like Nebuchadnezzar? Or just like Belshazzar? The fact is, we have to develop the love. That is the only way we can be Christians. If you don't develop it, you are not a Christian. You can call yourself a Christian, but you are not one. And trust me, by their fruits, you'll be able to know them. It doesn't matter how you call your Christians, how you call yourself a Christian. The fact is, if you don't love people, if you don't, I'm not talking about, you know, just bare talking about love. I'm talking about genuine love. Love that is within you. So we have to understand that. Let's continue and see the yardstick and see these things as what we could use to measure you as a Christian. And verse 3 says, and though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor. I mean, we do that a lot, Sister Grant. Sister Coda. Even if we do that to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned but have not love, it profits me nothing. So I want to let us know. I have come by here to tell you that you need to understand what this journey is all about. You need to know that you have to have that love. I am persuading us this morning to develop that love. Sometimes in the beginning, it could be difficult, but you have to. You have to be intentional to develop that love. Because if you don't develop that love, the Bible says you are nothing. I don't want to be nothing. I want to be something when Christ comes. Now, it begins to tell us what love actually is. It said, love suffers long and is kind. Now, see, that's why I love my Bible. You know, it tells you these things, and then you begin to expatiate on it one by one. It begins to tell you, Alex, it's good to see you. The Bible will begin to tell you what is happening. The Bible is telling you, listen, this love we are talking about, it suffers long and is kind. In other words, the love is patience. Hello? The love we talk about is patience. If I do you wrong now, you got to be patient with me. If somebody do me wrong, I got to be patient with them. You know, that's what it is. It says it does not parade itself, whatever that means. But you can answer that yourself. It says love does not parade himself. And it says love does not envy. It does not envy. We know what that means. We can't begin to envy some people because they are successful, or we have to, or because they've done something that you don't have, or because they are using their gifts that the Lord has given them very well, and you decide to bury your own at the back here. No need to be envious. He says, love is not puffed up. Our pastor preached about pride last Sabbath. And he says, pride goeth before a fall. You cannot be proud. And then you're talking about love. Let me tell you something. I used to be very proud. Extremely proud. In other words, if you're not in my class, forget it. I won't even talk to you. If you don't have what I have, I won't talk to you. Yes, I used to be proud, and that's the reason why sometimes when you tell your story, you tell your story and tell the bad ones too, so that it will give somebody hope. That listen, there was a time I was doing things that are wrong, but now I've been delivered by God Himself. And so yes, I was proud, and I know exactly what pride is. It takes you down, and when it takes you down, it takes you down flat. Takes you down flat. And I checked it out until I was delivered. Until I was delivered, I know that every single person that's been created is the same as me, if not better. And so the Lord delivered me. You can't deliver yourself if you're proud. You can't deliver yourself. You got to ask the Holy Spirit to intervene. You have to ask God to intervene. Pride is dangerous. And so it says, love is not proud, is not puffed up, does not behave rudely. Oh, let me talk about rudely. I know people that behave rudely, even outside here. Outside here, as soon as they leave, sometimes they are, something is happening within them. You know, I don't know what is happening within them, but they just get out of the foyer, the second foyer. As soon as they get out here, you see the words that come out of their mouth is so rude that you can't begin to say, oh, is he or she coming out of church? Is he coming out of the sanctuary? The fact is, you can't leave both walls. You can't combine being in the world and being in here. It's either you're in here or you're out there. We're not playing on the river and on the banks here. I keep telling us, we are not playing on the river and on the banks here, even though it's a game we play, Gloria. That's the game we play when we're doing social, on the river, on the bank. Right? You know what I'm talking about. Alex, you know what I'm talking about. You know, we're going to begin to play, you know, social again. You know, you get everybody. Get Travis. Get your brothers. Get your friends. Get them here. We've started church. The Lord is good. You know, it's good to see Alex, man. It's my guy. And let me tell you something. We are not playing here. But we cannot take life so serious. Take life simple. The Lord has given us His gospel. And I'm telling you today that gospel is not complicated. We like to make it complicated because we want to talk about all this prophecy and all these big things. Yes, they are important. But we want to love our neighbor as ourselves. You know, we can't be preaching, you know, these big things, and then we forget that Christ came here to teach us how to love one another, how to live with one another, and how to, I mean, don't worry about what is happening in the world. The Bible says in the last days, these things will be happening. So don't be surprised. Don't be surprised that we're getting COVID. In fact, more diseases are coming. So I'm telling you today, you need to buckle up. You need to guide your loins because they're coming. And I don't want them to take you by surprise. Because it's coming. Because the Lord says it will come. Just before the Son of Man appears in the clouds of heaven, it's going to come. And so, but the Lord is saying, hold on, love one another, continue to be loving, continue to do good things, continue to be kind, you know, Sister Holder, continue to be kind to one another, Sister Wisdom, continue to be kind with one another, continue to encourage one another. That's how we survive this race. That's how we survive this race. You are running in front of me, I'm seeing you running, you're not giving up, I'm coming with you. Somebody's behind me, he's running. It is not when It doesn't mean, you know, that we have to be there and get there and then maybe Joy got there before me and then she is waiting for me. The fact is, she can wait for me, but the fact is, she can be cheering me on and say, Benjamin, come on! You almost there, come on! That's the idea. So we need to know that love is good to have. Love is not provoked. Thinks no evil. You know, even if you provoke me, the fact is, I'm still going to love you. Even though I provoke you, the fact is, you still have to love me. Because that's the way we can measure us as being true Christians. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoice in the truth. Does not rejoice in iniquity, you know, in anything wrong, anything bad, you know, the love does not begin to rejoice. Oh, he had COVID. Oh, man, amen. He had COVID. Oh, okay. No, pray for him. Pray for her so that he or she can be made whole. He says, it believes all things. Believe in me. When I tell you things, believe in me. Let my no be no, let my yes be yes. Amen to that. And then it believes in all things, hope in all things, and endures all things. We have to understand that love is a big deal. We talk about the spirit of prophecy, we talk about the fruit of the spirit. Yeah, we talk about the fruit of the spirit. The fruit of the spirit is enveloped in love. You cannot be kind and not love. You cannot, you know, develop this nice fruit and not loving somebody. Love is the epitome of what we do as Christians. It is the height of what we do as Christians. It's what we should have. We shouldn't even ask questions. We shouldn't even talk about anything, but love is what we need to have as Christians. If you don't have that, the Bible says you are nothing. And I know you don't want to be nothing. The Bible says love is, so the spirit of the fruit of the spirit is enveloped in love. Even God's law is enveloped in love. The God's law, you have the one, the love you have for God, and then you have the love you have for man. It says, with all these things, hope, faith, love, the greatest is what? It's love. The greatest. I didn't say it. I didn't write it. It's here, right here in the Bible. He said it's the greatest of all three. It's love. I need you to ask yourself the question, do I love everyone? This is a question that you have to answer yourself. If you don't, begin to develop that and ask the Holy Spirit to help you, because you can't do it alone. You cannot do it alone, Sister Wilson. You cannot begin to develop the love, the genuine love for everyone alone. You have to ask the Holy Spirit to assist you, to help you. All you got to do is listen, follow his lead. Let me say that again. Follow the lead of the Holy Spirit. When he begins to tell you what you need to do, follow the lead. Don't say, well, don't begin to doubt. Don't begin to say, this is the way I want to do it. This is the way I want you to do it. This is the way I pray that you do it. No, it is the way he's leading you. That's the way you must follow. If you don't, then you are not doing the right thing. So it's going to be difficult for you to develop the love that we have. I have come by here to admonish us, to tell us, to ask us, to persuade us, you know, nicely, to nudge us nicely to begin to develop the love that we need to develop. Otherwise, you might have and know the entire prophecy in the Bible. You might have the tongue, you know, of an angel. You might know, you know, you might have the faith that is so magnificent or so, you know, so big that you can move mountains. But if you do not have love, let me tell you something, you are nothing. I am nothing. The fact is, we must love one another. We must learn to love one another. Loving one another means you call, you ask. Loving one another means you need to be kind, cook, take. Loving one another means you have to show it. You have to act it. You let me see it. I want you to see it. Because if you don't see it, you don't feel it, it's not happening. It's not there. If you can feel it, and if you can see it, then it's happening. Thank God. Because if you have love for one another, in fact, the journey is already done. If you have love for one another, genuine love, the agape love that the God has for us, it is already done. The battle is already won because you have what it takes to be a good Christian. You have what it takes. I have what it takes to stand for God, because there is no adulteration here. We cannot be adulterating things. Dr. Noro, where are you? I see you. We cannot begin to adulterate situations. It has to be pure, or it is nothing. If it's not it, it's not it. If that's what it is, then that's what it is. We have to learn to love one another. It doesn't matter what the situation is. Love one another. There is no place in the Bible that says if somebody has done so and so things, don't love them. Let me say that again because you're not listening. Some of us have gone to sleep on me. That's fine. The fact is, if you don't have that love, which is what we use to measure a true Christian, then you just don't have it. There is no two ways about it. The Bible is clear. There is no place the Bible says, if my sister or my brother has done such and so thing, then don't love him anymore. Have you ever read that? I know that. There's no way it says that. It doesn't matter what she's done. It doesn't matter what he has done. The fact is, the love remains unchanged. It's constant, if you know what I mean. It's constant. It's just there. You know, it is just there. You know, it can't change. Your mannerism could change. You know, what you do could change, but the love is constant. Let us keep that love, because the Lord has asked us to develop that. The Lord has asked us to develop that, because when we develop love, when we develop that love, you're going to find yourself living in peace with yourself. You're going to find yourself living in harmony with every single person. It doesn't matter what is happening out there in the world, but you will feel the harmony. You will feel the peace within you. And then when you do that, then you will spread the gospel. You will tell somebody, this is what is happening within me. I love what is happening within me. And then he or she will say, what? What is happening? I want to join you. And then you begin to dialogue. And then you begin to tell them about the second coming of Christ and what he has for you. Because he who said he will come, will come. And then he will come, and then he will do what he says he will do. He will take all of us who have kept that law burning. He will take us with him And at this point, I want to ask every single one who don't want to be nothing, who want to be something for God, to stand, please. If you know you want to be something for God, you want to do something for God, and then you don't want him to say, get out of my sight, I don't know you, please stand to your feet. I want you to stand to your feet if you can. If you can't, the Lord understands. I'm asking you, as we are standing, that you develop or rekindle the love that you have for everyone. Rekindle the love that you have for even your enemies. Rekindle it and keep moving, because that is the true measure. That is the true yardstick for a good Christian. May God bless us, and may God continue to be with us in everything that we do. As you remain standing, I'm going to call on the first elder to come and pray for you as you stand. Please. Just remain standing as she prays for us, and then
let us pray. Marvelous love of our loving Lord. Oh, what love he has demonstrated, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ came to die for humanity.
Yes.
And he expects us to do the same thing. Not that we are gone, but he demonstrated love. And he wants us as well to demonstrate love. Jam-packed in the Ten Commandments is love. Love for God, love the Lord thy God with all of our hearts, with all of our souls, and with all of our might. And then the second part of that is to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. But too often we want to do check marks. I don't kill. I don't steal. I don't worship the stone. But God, you're asking us that if we have that deep-seated love, then it will come naturally, whereby we are able to love God as he has indicated. As well, if we love our neighbor as we love ourselves, then we would not want to harm anyone. And so, Father, we thank you for your manservant who has preached this word today. May it resonate in our hearts and in our minds that indeed love covers a multitude of sin. Indeed, love is what will lead to eternal life, because when we love, we would want to go out and spread the gospel message of salvation so others can be saved in your eternal kingdom. And so, Father, I pray that this moment, each one of us, whether online, whether on Facebook, whether by YouTube or other social media, or those who are physically in the sanctuary, that we will think about the love of Jesus. And not only think about the love of Jesus, maybe we have wronged someone, maybe we have this hatred in our heart or dislike in our heart for somebody, dear God. And God, today, God, we are praying that you will allow us to make it right through your Holy Spirit. So anoint hearts, anoint us all. And God, we will experience this love that we must go and tell. But not only go and tell, we will put others in front of us. We will outdo one another in love. And so, God, we just want to thank you for the sermon. And we thank you for the practicality that we will put it in practice. And we thank you, God, for change mindsets and change hearts. In Jesus' name, we thank you and praise you. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. You may be seated, please. You may be seated.
Please stand for the closing hymn. Thank you, Elder, for the word today. We speak of the realms, hymn number 434.
We speak of the realms of the blessed, that countries so bright and so fair, and all for its glories confess. But what must it be to be there? We speak of its pathway of gold, its walls that quench you will so rare, its wonders and pleasures untold. To be there, we speak of its freedom from sin, from sorrow, temptation, and care, from trials without and within. But what must it be to be there? We speak of its service of love. Church of the first boy above, but what must it be to be there? Our morning is on at hand, and we're raised by the life-giving word. We see the new city
bow our heads for the benediction. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen and amen. May God be with you as we go.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen.
Let the church
church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say you may be seated. You'll be ushered out.
cross my Savior made me whole.
Made me whole.
My sins were washed away, and my night was such a day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Born of the Spirit with life from above, into God's family divine, justified fully through Calvary's love. Transaction so quickly was made, when as a sinner I came to God, the offer of grace in it proper. He saved me, your praises their name. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. My Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day when at the cross I believed. Riches eternal and blessings supernal from His precious hand I received. Oh, heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
Filled my soul.
When at the cross my Savior made me whole. Sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
My sins were washed away.
My sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day.